It's my pleasure. I'm Michael Flyer, by the way, from the Ukrainian Research Institute here, and it's my pleasure to be able to introduce a very old, good,
old
solid
in
friend.
The sense of
of long standing.
Yes, of long standing, but eternally young spiritually.
Eternally young.
Harvey Goldblatt from Yale University, professor of medieval Slavic literature. Harvey has published widely, very widely, in Slavic medieval literature and culture, going all the way from the Balkans and now with a special interest in the East Slavic heritage. His current project, part of which he's going to talk about today, concerns a major study of the Ihor tale, which of course is a much argued text, as well as various aspects of the Cyrillo-Methodian literary tradition. He has a two-volume collection of studies that's going to be published in Poland early next year under the title Studies on the Medieval and Premodern Literary Civilization of Russia and Ukraine, a volume of his articles, and on the writings and thought of Ivan Wyszynski, soon will be published in Ukrainian by Krytyka Publishing House. And finally, there's another multi-volume collection that contains 60 of his mentor's articles, that is Ricardo Picchio's studies, annotated all in English, and that's going to appear in late 2018. Today's talk, which as is always the case with Harvey's titles, they all look like Dickens titles, what did the Chronicles really mean? What did they really want to say? Revisiting the Laurentian and Hypatian Chronicle accounts about the raid of Prince Ihor Svjatoslavyc in 1185. It's my pleasure to introduce Harvey Goldblatt.
Thank you. I will try and be as informal as I can. I often tend to either be very funny or very formal, nothing in between. I want to say what an enormous pleasure it is to be here, and there is perhaps not quantity, but there is great quality in this room, and I am really delighted. I'm very, very happy to. I've always felt at home here in the Institute and always been treated so well. Just a brief apology. My assistant made some of these handouts, but she did not insert my corrections. So there are a large number of mistakes. $5 for each. I do apologize for it. But I intentionally made a very large number of handouts. I hope they don't confuse you. I will try to be as precise as possible when necessary. And I'm really just, I want to introduce a number of problems as I often do, whether I have answers that please you or that are clear in terms of, I remember Professor Pritzak saying at the end of every lecture, good, the problem is solved. And I guess I have a different orientation, but really it's a pleasure to be here, and I'll just try and introduce a couple of points. I hope you find them interesting. The starting point, of course, is what do I mean by the two accounts in the Laurentian Chronicle and Hypatian Chronicles. It's important to note that one of them is dated 1185, that's Hypatian, the other, Laurentian, is 1186. And I think the most important thing for me as I begin a project like this is to really operate with a distinction, and after that distinction has been made, to try and focus on what I normally do. Perhaps I don't do it best, but it's what I normally do. So when looking at these documents, and I'll intentionally use that term, historians clearly seek out a realia, information on what took place in the 12th century, what really happened. And that's not what I do. I question, perhaps far more than historians, information that is presented. And my task is, how is a narrative conveyed? And if not just how, but why is the narrative conveyed in the way it is? What is the specific mode of presentation? For me, the underlying motif is the literary and spiritual heritage. And I in no way mean to diminish the importance of historical work. It's simply that my task is different. Let's just make sure we understand what we are talking about. The terms Laurentian Chronicle and Hypatian Chronicle are confusing in themselves. That is to say, a particular manuscript, which was compiled by a certain Lavrenti in 1377, is called the Laurentian Chronicle, meaning the actual text. However, there is the Laurentian compilation, of which the Laurentian Chronicle is only one part. Our real task is, the first task when discussing the problem of chronicles, is to work and deal with the problem of compilations, svody. This is something that has been of enormous importance ever since Alexei Shakhmatov began his research in the late 19th century. The same applies to Hypatian. Hypatian is in reference to where this manuscript allegedly was written, in a monastery called the Hypatian Monastery, and as a result, a particular manuscript is called the Hypatian Chronicle Manuscript, but also a compilation that we have is called the Hypatian Chronicle. That distinction, though perhaps obvious and perhaps unnecessary to underscore, is extremely important because we should not assume that what we have in the Laurentian manuscript in and of itself, that one textual witness, corresponds to what we have in a whole series of texts in three basic versions, but there's far more to discuss in regard to Laurentian, and same thing applies to Hypatian. And the reason I mentioned Shakhmatov is the enormous influence he has had on the discussion of chronicles, particularly the idea that the essence of what we are seeking is a process of compilation which leads to a series of redactions, let's call them editorial events. And in that series, it would be extremely important to identify points, seams, or some discontinuity that would allow us to say, aha, there's another scribe and perhaps another version that begins at this point. Sometimes there are markers that helped Shakhmatov and others. Other times there aren't such markers. And these editorial events, those moments when we had a shift to perhaps a new orientation, a new way of writing, it all depends. For Shakhmatov, this was far more significant than anything to do with the accretion of an analytic material. His goal was always to identify a svod, a compilation, and to see how many of them he could detect. The problem is, in my view, with Shakhmatov's work, and who am I? I always say, who am I to criticize Shakhmatov? But his ultimate aim often was not only to see documents as political documents, but also to try to go back to some hypothetical original text that of course was based only on supposition and not on philologically studied material that we have at our disposal. But the fact is that this focus on redactions and this focus on compilations and this focus on finding seams, which would help us determine perhaps different stages in the development of a larger work, seams in the fabric of a chronicle text, we might say, this was extremely influential. And the people following Shakhmatov, Mikhail Prisyolkov, Gelian Prokhorov, these are people who've worked on this area. And more recent, I would say, Alexei Gippius and Alan Timberlake are people who continued, it would seem, to believe in or to share Shakhmatov's belief in the centrality of redactions and new compilations. So that's one thing. Then when we get to a comparison of the two compilations, and there are a number of people who have written on this, the fact is that we have, when we're dealing with the second half of the 12th century, the material in the second half of the 12th century, we're dealing with two very different traditions. That is to say, until about 1150 or a little later, we have a common, more or less a common textual tradition that belongs to both the initial portion of the Laurentian Chronicle and the initial portion of the Hypatian Chronicle. It's what we know, what we often call the Rus Primary Chronicle or the Tale of Bygone Years or what have you. However, beginning around 1157, and this is very much connected with the reign of Andrei Bogolyubsky and the ambitious designs of Bogolyubsky in the north or northeast, we have the creation of a very different kind of chronicle, a chronicle that is complex, a chronicle that clearly has completely different aims from the continuation of the chronicle in the south, the so-called Hypatian. And for Shakhmatov, the ambition of the northeastern princes is crucial, and the creation of a new and great capital, Vladimir, was also crucial, and it's for that reason Shakhmatov called this text not the Laurentian Chronicle, but which is very confusing, and I apologize for using it, but everyone continues to. He called it the Vladimir Chronicle, which makes a lot more sense. He believed that this was compiled in the city of Vladimir, perhaps at the end of the 12th century, perhaps at the beginning of the 13th century, and again connected with the ambitions of the essentially descendants of Monomach, the Monomachici, if you want, which sounds very Czech when I say that. So that Vladimir Chronicle is not at all a bad idea. What is important is Shakhmatov's conclusion, and most scholars continued to follow him, is that we have the development, the formation and development of a writing tradition in the Northeast that is continuous and very much linked with the Northeast and very different from what we find in the Hypatian. Now, this is very nice and very interesting, but it raises a large number of problems when we are talking about the particular account of Ihor's raid in the Laurentian Chronicle and an account in the Hypatian Chronicle. It is striking to me how this problem of studying these two texts, which allegedly are southern in origin, and I stress the word allegedly, it is striking to me the extent to which people have actually just taken these texts as if they were written, the account of Ihor's raid by Lavrenti. It's not at all an appropriate way to study what we are doing. We need to study a particular context in each of these compilations within which it would be appropriate to examine the account of Ihor's raid. Now, the second issue that is very important, if we take these two accounts, and this is typical of what Shakhmatov often said, they of course came from somewhere else and were inserted. Some people say mechanically inserted. They are separate works. They were mechanically inserted into the Laurentian Chronicle and the Hypatian Chronicle. But what if they weren't? Because they weren't. What if they weren't? What happened to them? How were they adapted? And to what extent can we identify the elements of that adaptation? That is extremely important. to do. Those are our first thing that one should do, and I trust that what I'm saying is fairly logical. If we start with the Laurentian Chronicle, on the basis of Alan Timberlake's evidence, he wrote a very fine article in 2000, we can distinguish four different segments, beginning in 1177. And the particular segment that is of importance to us is 1185b to 1188. By b, we mean the second portion of text under the year 1185. And we'll get to some of those components in a moment. So 1177 to 1185a is something that really needs to be studied, but the focus today, we have very limited time, will be on this section from 1185b, the second component in under the year 1185 to 1188. This is in the Laurentian Chronicle. So what we're going to study today, hopefully God willing and time permitting, you can put on, I don't know which one you want to put first, our larger context for the account of the raid. As I said, it will be that portion I've just mentioned, 1185 to 1188. We can't do all of it, but I want to do, by the way, let's start with the handouts now. If you want to look at the Laurentian and Hypatian versions of the account of Ihor's raid, you can look at handout 2, pages 6 to 8. So what we're going to study as a context in Laurentian is first 1185b, that first element I mentioned, which is on the great fire of the city of Vladimir, and that would be pages 2 and 3 of that same handout 2. And then second, we're going to study or look at, we don't have time to study, 1185c, which is the Rus princes, or perhaps Vladimir Glebovich, triumph over the Polovcians. That is page 4 of the very same handout, handout number 2. So that's what hopefully we're going to get to. Some textual, a couple of textual excerpts and the actual raid. When it comes to Hypatian, the larger segment, the larger context that I would like to deal with, or that at least will be fodder or food for our perusal, are the years 1180 to 1186. I'm sorry. 1180 to 1186, which can be referred to as the reigns of the duumvirate Svatoslav Sevolodovich and Rurik Rostoslavich. So we'll look at the account, which is much longer. The account of Ihor's raid is much longer in the Hypatian than in the Laurentian. That would be pages 6 to 12, really, that the Hypatian. We will discuss the following textual units. The one I just mentioned for Hypatian on the great fire in the city of Vladimir, which is page 2 in the same handout, handout 2. 1184, which is Svyatoslav and Rurik triumph over the Polovtsians. And finally, 1185a, which is the same handout, page 4, Svyatoslav and Rurik triumph over the Polovtsians. What I've tried to do, of course, in the handout 2 is give you some, to the extent possible, the possibility of comparing the text, and I apologize for using English, but I think it might have been more complicated if I hadn't. But as I said, there are many mistakes in the English. And
is this your translation?
It would have been far more of my translation, the correction have been inserted. Most of it is, yeah. But there are lots of problems. It's a long story, but thank you for asking. Yes, most of it is. And there are things that, as I say, need to be worked on. These are the operations. Let me just sum up here. The operations that are involved here, it seems to me. First, we need to analyze autonomously the textual units presenting Ihor's campaign. That would be one in Hypatian, one in Laurentian. As I said, the Hypatian is much longer. They are very, very different. Second, these textual units need to be evaluated in the larger chronicle contexts we have just identified, one in Laurentian, one in Hypatian. And third, we could engage in the process of comparison for certain thematic units, or we might even say thematic commonplaces. So we would have an obvious place, beginning on page 2 of that handout, a comparison of the initial campaigns, comparison of the accounts on the fire in Vladimir, pages 2 to 3, a comparison of the initial campaigns against the Polovcians before Ihor's separate campaign. So in other words, Laurentian Chronicle 1185C versus Hypatian 1184 and 1185A on pages 4 to 5. And finally, a comparison of the two accounts devoted to the campaign. This way, we approach things in different ways and provide a context. It is important to stress that this is a limited context for a limited amount of information I wish to provide to you today. The context would be larger when writing a larger work on this subject. We will see part of that, obviously, even today. Now, this is lovely. We can examine the two chronicle accounts right now, move right there, and be very, very happy. And I don't know how much time I have, so it's going to be very difficult. But you can't study the two chronicle accounts without studying the famous Slovo, the Ihor tale, whatever you want to call it, because the extent to which our research has either been research on Hypatian Chronicle and Laurentian Chronicle have not only been connected with the Ihor tale, but the extent to which the historiographic or interpretive trends, movements, ideas connected with the Ihor tale have influenced the reading of both chronicles makes it impossible to avoid the Ihor tale. And I apologize for that because I have a lot of information which I will... How much time do I have so I can really make sure I get to the chronicles?
Whether we're really talking about 20, maybe 25 minutes.
25 minutes, okay. I think most of you know that I have taken the work of Ricardo Picchio as a point of departure when he emphasized a number of things about the Ihor tale and have tried to continue in my own way on this subject. The basic point is that in contrast to a wide variety of interpretive trends, in particular the notion of the so-called poem being regarded as secular and the suggestion that there is only a minor Christian thread or process of repentance in the Ihor tale. Actually, there isn't one, but that's what is often written. And the poet's worldview was still thoroughly pagan with few Christian elements. I'm quoting from two scholars here who are among many. My position is extremely, is quite different. I see the work as a religious exemplum that needs to be examined and that can be examined against the same ecclesiastical tradition that conditioned the production of almost all literary monuments in Old Rus. More specifically, I want to emphasize the fact that the Ihor tale appears to be based on the concept of covenant curses and blessings that are first contained in the formulaic commonplaces of the Deuteronomistic prophetic tradition of conversion or change of mind, and then highlighted and reshaped in the work of St. Paul. And it is St. Paul's work that has sparked, for me, the greatest interest in viewing this work. Now, I do not have time for this, and I apologize, but let me just say there are two ways in which my work has tried to examine the ecclesiastical orientation of this work. First, a series of scriptural allusions. There are no citations of scripture in this work. Allusions that are covered, really are present in all parts of the work. I've In handout number 5, I have a whole series, I think there are 85 or 86 citations. I'll just give you the numbers of the what I see as scriptural allusions in the Ihor tale and corresponding scriptural references or liturgical references that might be helpful. So you could look at in handout 5, number 1, with accompanying references 2 to 19. In other words, these are scriptural suggestions for you. Number 20, with accompanying reference 21. 22, with accompanying references 23, 25. 36, with accompanying references 37, 38. 39, with accompanying references 40 to 45, 59. As well, 40 to 45 and 50, and finally 46 with accompanying references 47, 58. What I want to stress, and I will have to leave it at this point, is this way of reading is very fruitful, and I think it can be demonstrated to be extremely helpful in interpreting this very complex work. But I think there's something more important here, not simply the specific references here that direct us to a higher or spiritual level of meaning. And here we have this important opposition of sensus literalis and sensus spiritualis. Not just that, but the fact that we have clearly an orthodox doctrine that we can identify, in my view, that applies specifically to Rus in the period prior to the Mongol invasions. And it is a doctrine that, again, is primarily explained for us, it would seem, in the writings of St. Paul, particularly his letter to Romans. And what I want to suggest here is that what you have in St. Paul, even if you take chapter 2 of Romans, is not simply a Heilsgeschichte, a salvatory history that is continuous to its fulfillment, but all of these other aspects that are crucial to an understanding of the Chronicles in the 11th century and the 12th century and the Ihor tale and the, to some degree, the accounts that we will read. What I mean by that is there are, within this salvatory activity of God, a number of crucial contrasts that never go away. The tension between the seminal events of creation and covenant theology, wherein God is always faithful in mercy, but on the other hand, the constant disobedience of man, Adam's disobedience and man's repeated sin committed against God, and also, therefore, the tension between the judgment of God provoked by man's rebellion as well as his divine wrath. Finally, and most important, the possibility of forgiveness through redemption with the restorative faithfulness of Christ on the cross and his resurrection, representing, of course, the seminal moments in the history of humankind. Now, these are not specific references, but I'm convinced that an understanding of Pauline doctrine, not in some general way from a secondary source that I've always been distressed by people who write about Dostoevsky's Christianity and then they take a handbook and just quote from it. I'm talking about a specific doctrine that I can abstract from the Chronicles, And that's what I am talking about. I'm talking about salvation history as operating through the agency of, in the broadest sense, the children of Israel, which St. Paul, of course, reshapes. Now, what's interesting for me is if I go back to scriptural allusions, in handout 1, you see a compositional scheme of the Ihor tale. If you look at parts 1 and 3 of my compositional scheme, almost all of the scriptural allusions are based on the Old Testament. Old Testament citations or citations found from the Old Testament in the liturgical tradition. That is to say, prophetic citations or warnings that point to the dire implications of rebelling against God. It's only in part four that something else happens. Now, we don't know why it happens in the Ihor tale, but the fact is it does, that God leads Ihor to liberation. Clearly, repentance has taken place. Perhaps there's the impact of the intercession of Yaroslavna, his wife, but these are different issues. But the fact is that we have, quote, in the New Testament, the New Testament suddenly becomes dominant in part four, which shouldn't surprise one, given that Ihor is liberated, has repented, and will be saved and returns home. So let's look at the two chronicle accounts. Now, I'm not going to spend time on some of the details concerning differences, but everything is different. That is to say, Hypatian is different from the Ihor tale. Laurentian is very different from the Ihor tale, and Hypatian is different from Laurentian. This is not simply a question of textual material, but also thematic motifs. It is the differences that are striking, despite efforts by many to link particularly the Hypatian with what we find. So let's now actually go through very briefly some of the points that I think we could make. And I have, I guess, about 10 minutes. Is that correct? Is that?
Yeah, a little bit.
I will do my best to. I'm really moving along here. So first point I've made, a religious or ecclesiastical interpretation is required for all three works. And the fact is that I have, as I said earlier, I see these works in a very, very different way, and I would like to offer a kind of literary didactic reading. And what's most important, if we take both of the accounts of Ihor's raid in Hypatian and Laurentian, we're talking not about mechanical insertions, but about constructs that aren't different even in formal usage, in language, from what surrounds them. So if indeed in Laurentian it's a southern episode, we would have to answer why it's southern and what is southern about the episode. That has not been done. And now I have a little note here. And now, finally, back to the Chronicles with three exclamation points. All right. Quickly, Hypatian 1184, we will compare that, Hypatian 1185a, and this is all in your second handout, we will compare those with what we find in Laurentian 1185. This has to do with campaigns against the Polovcians, and what's interesting is the differences that take place. Let me just get my notes here because I think they are over here. Yes. So if we take 1184, we will notice that, first of all, Svyatoslav and Rurik are co-rulers. This is something that is found only in Hypatian. It's never found in the Ihor tale, and it's never found in Laurentian. Svyatoslav and Rurik are good, and the Lord opposes the proud because he is opposes the proud and he is merciful. The proud in this particular case does not refer to Svyatoslav and Rurik, but instead to the Polovcians. Konchak, therefore, is godless and accursed, opposed by God. Important point about Hypatian 1184, there is no reference to Ihor whatsoever. Okay? Now, in 1185a, we have the Lord working his salvation on behalf of Rus with Kiev and the Kiev and land as a political and spiritual center. So we can see here the important connection between salvation for Rus and Kiev. This is a crucial point that is made in the Hypatian and is most definitely not made in the Laurentian. The harmony of princes, and is a fascinating theme, with the exception of Yaroslav, this is very much a harmony among, above all, the Olgovici, the descendants of Oleg Gorislavich or Svjatoslavich, very famous, and the founder of the Olgovichi. What is important here is not any form of betrayal of Ihor or any sense that he doesn't want to go on the trip, that he's a bad fellow. No, the opposite. He misses the campaign, but he has no control over that. And when his Druzhina says to him, "You can't make it," he is angry with the Druzhina. It's something very different than what is set up certainly in the Ihor tale and certainly in the Laurentian. So what happens with a very similar account? Notice they're not at all, it is not clear in Laurentian what particular events are being referred to, because there are many more separate campaigns in Hypatian. This has not been suggested, not been stressed sufficiently either. But we have a very different situation in Laurentian for 1185C. It is not one prince. There is no leader. There are a bunch of fellows. There's Svyatoslav and Rurik and Vladimir Glebovich. He will be very important for our story. So there's Vladimir Glebovich who will be important, and there are the two co-rulers, but no one is suggested as co-rulers. No one. It is clear that what is being presented to us is a kind of collective without a particular leader. God has put into the hearts of the Rus princes a certain idea. And this would seem to be obviously a suggestion of, if indeed they move against the Polovcians, it would be seen as a positive decision. Now the Polovcians, interestingly, are placed in a kind of liminal state. On the one hand, they have some sense that they may defeat, or in reference to a previous battle, they have defeated the Rus. But then there is a crucial passage, which is repeated in the account of Ihor's raid in the Laurentian Chronicle. There's a word here. It's fine here. It's in my version. It's not yours. There is no wisdom, no counsel, no bravery or counsel that can stand up to the Lord. That is just very close to what we find in the Ihor tale about judgment of God. So what is interesting is the idea that is presented here of Polovcians who may rely on their own strength, and they may even lose their pride, but they are completely dependent on the actions of God. This is perhaps one of the most important points, because throughout the Chronicles, after the initial depiction of the Polovcians as evil in 1061, by 1066, the theology is clear. We have sinned, we are evil, God has punished us, and as in olden times, as with the Assyrians and as with the Babylonians, the Polovcians are the agent of God. The Polovcians are the agent of God. And this theme, which is only hinted at here in 1185, will become the crucial theme in the actual account. Another couple of points that are important. As you're reading this, Vladimir Glebovich emerges as a great hero, and the Polovcians flee because of him. Some people have focused on the fact this must have been taken from the Pierson Chronicle. That may be true. But what is important is that there is something being set up here in a broader sense. Hypatian will make use of this. Hypatian will make use of this because the confession of Ihor in the account of Ihor's raid, the confession was based on the fact that he has sinned against his brothers, such as Vladimir Glebovich. So on the one hand, you can look at historical reality and see important distinctions between the descendants of Monomach and the descendants of Oleg. They're already fading to some degree. But the other point that is so important is that the Polovcians flee because of God's wrath and the Theotokos, the mother of God. Now, clearly, this is a reference to the fact that there is some larger power connected with Vladimir. Theotokos is not anywhere in Hypatian. It will be everywhere in Laurentian because Theotokos is the patron saint. The special icon, as you know, goes to Vladimir. The protection that had once been in Constantinople now will come to Vladimir and so forth. So these are incredibly important points that I only can hint to today because we don't have time. Now, I will just switch and let's do the two accounts and I will end there. I will just do this. The Hypatian is extremely interesting because it suggests that Ihor has sinned, and in fact God has punished him for his sins. But what is the sin of Ihor? The sin of Ihor is the fact that he has engaged in the kind of activity that is repeated over and over again in the Chronicles. He has sinned by, and he's very specific, by his assaults on Vladimir Glebovich. And he confesses to that. Now, one point that's crucial. In the fire scene, if you look at page 2, you will see a very short passage on the fire in Vladimir, in Hypatian, but a tremendously important commentary in the larger section, which talks exactly about sinning and punishment and makes use of all kinds of citations that are taken from the excerpts of the 11th century chronicle. And it is those citations that were repeated over and over again until 1188. So the construct, I called it, of Laurentian, okay, the construct of Laurentian, the account of Ihor's raid in Laurentian is based entirely on that vision, based entirely on the assaults of the immoral, improper assaults of the offspring of Oleg. Ihor sometimes is barely mentioned. And this leads to a discussion of, yes, those who are righteous will be liberated. So there is some small implication that Ihor may in fact have engaged in some sort of repentance, something that is much clearer in Hypatian. He goes the icon and the cross. In Laurentian, that's not there. And what the Laurentian ends with is an extremely important focus on punishment, an extremely important focus on the diabolical actions of the evil one. If I had enough time, I would try to point out that much of this is a kind of, in modern terms, a search for a leader, a search for a leader who can restore harmony to this evil place. And that leader is Vsyevolod Yurevich, the prince. In 1186, if you look at the Laurentian treatment of Ihor's raid, he is called Grand Prince in the second paragraph in Laurentian. That's extremely important, first time. He's called Grand Prince, not Prince. One last point. So, I would go into details, but Andrei Bogolyubsky and Vsyevolod Yurevich and all of the things that take place, including the patron, the focus on the Marian feasts and on the Mother of God and all of that. And the reason I want to say that is the first page in your handout two, and I will finish with this and then just read my conclusion, if I may. you'll notice something very similar. If you look at the first page on the appointment of a bishop for Rostov, it seems fairly innocent, wouldn't you say? But it's not. This too has tremendous importance in the Hypatian. It's very simple. Metropolitan wants someone for the archbishop or the archbishopric, the archbishop see arch. What does it say in English? Archbishop.
Bishopric.
The archbishopric. Yes, I'm. You know, I'm learning. I'll get my English.
That's okay.
The see in Rostov, and it's very simple. He says, "I want Nick." I always say Nick the Greek. Nicholas the Greek. Now that itself doesn't sound very positive. Nicholas the Greek, but. The people don't want Nicholas the Greek, and in any event, notice in Hypatian, Vsevolod and Svyatoslav get together, and as a unity, again, the implication here is the center is still in Rus, and it's a unified area, they get together, and they decide that not the bad Nicholas the Greek, but the good Luke will be chosen, who is humble in spirit and meek. That's all we hear about him. We're going to hear he's humble in spirit and meek in Laurentian, but it's a completely different arrangement. What happens in 1185 is Nicholas the Greek, in the rotten and the rotten, corrupt ecclesiastic system, take a bribe from Nicholas, and that's how Nicholas is chosen. And God and the Theotokos, of course, and Vsevolod think this is just awful. Luke is desired by God, the Theotokos, and Prince Vsevolod. I think that says it all. A very different story. And what happens is, of course, Luke is appointed as the Bishop of Rostov. And it's under his domain in those years I mentioned from 1185 to 1188, where the focus is so much on punishment and sin. And that's also extremely interesting. The point being here is that in the ambitious vision of Prince Vsevolod and the ambitions for Vladimir, we see the also the ecclesiastical side. This is the person who will have a harmonious clergy, a pure clergy. He will be a great ruler, and he is the obvious leader and the only possible leader for Rus, because that is what is desired by both God and the Theotokos. So all I've tried to point out to you is how many different things need to be said about all of these things. And this is the passage. Notice that this is the year before the fire. The fire was supposed to start something new. We have, it's much more complicated than taking one segment as opposed to another. Because this section on the appointment of a bishop is extremely, extremely important, and I could say much more. I have something in a conclusion, so let me just read that, and then I will leave you alone. So if we take the so-called sensus literalis, so the literal level of meaning, the focus in the Hypatian Chronicle rests on the themes of Olgovici harmony and the hope for Olgovici monomachici reconciliation, within a vision that continues to place Kiev and the princes Svyatoslav Vsevolodovich and Rurik Rostislavich at the center of Rus history and politics. In the Igor Teod's only Svyatoslav, Grand Prince Svyatoslav, as he is called, but only in Igor Teod. On the other hand, the relevant Laurentian chronicle textual units, deeply embedded as they are in the worst excesses of fraternal strife, Usobica, and discord, Kramola, highlighted in earlier narratives of the primary chronicle, and that you could look at, I think it's four, right, which give you the sources. Handout four will give you the sources for the Laurentian. So these things highlighted in earlier narratives of the primary chronicle underscore not only the opposition between the Olovici and the Monashici as well as the need for overcoming the sins of the disobedient and rebellious Rus princes, but also the emergence of Grand Prince Vsevolod Yurievich, the Big Nest, as he was called, of Vladimir as the new and ambitious sovereign capable of restoring fraternal harmony and a spiritually cleansed church and clergy, and thereby firmly set on establishing both secular and ecclesiastical supremacy over the lands of Rus. That is the so-called literal sense or historical sense. At the sensus spirituale, so the spiritual level of meaning, we can also observe important differences between the textual units found in the Laurentian Chronicle and those contained in the Hypatian. Whereas the Hypatian entities reveal the sinful actions of Ihor Svjatoslavyc, and that goes back a while, which are placed against the backdrop of a providential history that is marked by God's faithfulness and mercy, together with man's redemption and salvation, despite man's rebellion against God and resulting divine wrath. Prince Igor's bowing before the icon of God and the Venerable Cross, his liberation and his return, notice, first to Novgorod-Siversky, his town, then to Chernihiv, his Chernihiv dynasty, and then to Kiev, where Svatoslav is. Everything in threes is perfection. All these motifs aim to illuminate ultimately a spiritual world of goodness and harmony in a Rus still with Kiev at its center. The Laurentian textual unit, on the other hand, exposes to view not only a much more negative evaluation of Prince Igor's pride and rebellion, but also a much darker vision of sin, as well as divine anger and judgment. Notwithstanding God's, as we read in the Laurentian, God's desire never to abandon the righteous man, provided that he fears God and prays to him for redemption. I'll stop here. Thank you. I'll be happy to answer any questions you might have.
Well, since we seem to have established a tradition in the last couple of years of the host of the event beginning the first question, so I'll jump in with one question, however, not one before. This, of course, opens up all kinds of possibilities of where we could go. But the one thing I'm interested in, since what you want to do is take a tale which, at least at one level, has very many secular aspects, combining it with a whole martial tradition, the military tale, a tremendous number of references to raw nature, and to paganism, who ultimately is the audience that we're going to put all these together and understand how they relate? It's hard to imagine that it's going to be the troops on the horses in the Druzhina. Who, and it's also, if it's not them, then it's hard to imagine that it's just monks in a monastery. So I'm curious
a couple of things. This, I think, in many ways remains unknown, but we should go back to an article that was written for your Festschrift by Viktor Markovich Zhivov, where he attempts to do something which is just as unlikely, in my view, the idea that this was court poetry that was... and perhaps Daniil Zatochnik somehow was a similar kind of work, and these works are the examples of something that speaks of a secular tradition and so forth. But then Viktor Markovich himself, near the end of his article, has to point out that from a very early time, these works were copied in monasteries. Now, his main point is that they weren't copied very much because they were the way they were. In other words, because they had all the features that you highlighted. And the response to that would be, I think everyone's, why would this have been done? This doesn't make any sense. There was no audience. And therefore, we move into another area called mystification and suspicion of authenticity and so forth. So I'm trying to resolve it by focusing on a tradition that if this thing were copied or reshaped, I'm convinced it's a later reshaping anyway. The compositional scheme suggests that, that this is as early as Franco. He talked about the fact this could not have been put together as a single work, and there were separate songs that were sung, and finally they were all put together. And Hrushevsky is the other major person who talks about the fact that this, the epilogue could not have been written by the same person, so it's a different author. And all of, so we have a number of questions, but I think I don't think the allusions that I'm suggesting would necessarily have been picked up. It is quite possible that the literal sense of this work and the things that you see are in fact all that was seen by certain groups who read this. That it's the only thing that makes any sense. But there might be something else.
Or who had it read to them.
Or who had
they
it
were
read.
Illiterate.
Of course. Yes, that's okay. What I meant.
George.
Well, thank you very much. This was really very interesting. But as already Michael's question suggests, the large unstated question, which obviously you are also implicitly recognizing as such, is how does this support or confirm the issue of the validity, the authenticity of the Ihor tale, precisely because there is so much interesting evidence here, and the very fact that there are two different traditions or two different versions would allow us to get at some issues, mm-hmm. presumably. So this is very good. I mean, my basic question is, could you or do you have a way of addressing that issue on the basis of what you have here? Is this the first handout a kind of a
this is the scheme I use, and I have a complete composition of this work, mm-hmm. which if read I hope would help.
I see. And which of the two, the Hypatian or the Laurentian, is the closer? Presumably, the Ihor tale.
I think
draws on both.
Yeah.
Because both elements are, in a sense, present.
If that's true, that would be an important consideration. The more obvious one is the Hypatian. Everyone suggests that,
yes.
including the presence of the middle section, yes. Svjatoslav, and so forth. Absolutely. But you see, we have a situation where the manuscript may be lovely but non-existent,
yes.
in regard to the Ihor tale. A text that I remember Mr. Pritzak again, Professor Pritzak again, suggested a certain day in which this work was written in 1187,
yes.
and Professor Picchio responded, "This is brilliant. I really love this. This is what I loved about them." And he would say, "Just I have one question, Professor Pritzak. Was it the morning or the afternoon?" Right now, the dating question is extremely difficult. All we know is that there is a manuscript which allegedly had other works in it. The Musim Pushkinsky Zbornik,
yes.
and that this text that we have clearly shows Novgorodian Pskovian features. It shows, from what we can determine, a post so-called second South Slavic influence. So this is a fairly late. There were even attempts, and I know that Ned tried to also include that possible question with Kalaidovich's
yes.
conclusions about the Ruthenian question, Polish-Ruthenian question.
Yes.
So that is one of the difficulties we have, because to what extent was work going on in the north? I mean, the northern so-called features that we see in this text, but they're only linguistic. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, there has been considerable emphasis placed on the fact that in this in the Ihor tale, interestingly enough, and whether it's ironic or not is not the point, but Vsevolod Yurievich is called Grand Prince as well, not just Svyatoslav. Mm-hmm. So we have all kinds of, I think that what a full examination requires is, again, highlighting all of the things you've mentioned, and then highlighting all of the things that have been done by a whole range of, whether it's Martin Dimnik or Zimin, of course, and others, as regards the specifics of the historical situation.
If I can just follow up, because the usual approach of those of the five-volume Igor Tail Encyclopedia and the Lihachov camp is to nickel and dime individual references. You know, it's not,
absolutely,
you know, it is not Urime, it is Urimie, you know? Because Ned says, you know, where does Urim v'Tumim come from, you know, if this came in the 17th century, you know, the Yale.
Yeah, I've heard of it.
You have too. Yes. And then they did it. Here you're providing a potentially, you know, systematic approach.
That's the only approach.
Yes,
yeah, because the focus,
yes,
the problem is it's the forest and the trees,
yes,
image
is
also.
Which is very heartening, you know, because yeah, finally it is a kind of a genuine engagement with the problem and not just, you know, saying, no, you got it wrong, it's not true, and besides, we found this one instance, so it shows that it's not a hapax legomenon, you know, because
right,
there are too many of them otherwise. But maybe you're not ready now, because you stuck to the Hypatian and Laurentian Chronicles and not to its relation to the ego.
Well,
but
I had so little time.
Is there the evidence already, in a sense, that leads in that direction, and where would you find it? Is it in the way that Igor has represented of the tale is consistent with the understanding there that is presented
I think these are very and we'll use an I'll use another textual critical word, these texts are all the chronicles are very contaminated.
Mm-hmm.
What one of the things I sort of started with was if Mazon and Zimin and Ned are correct, buonanotte. Then there's no need to do anything.
No,
but what I'm saying is if they're correct. Now, what I did with regard to the lexical, because the problem in Ned's book was it was exclusively on he focused on lexical items. And what I did was take each one of them and point out that they were everywhere in the Russian Slavonic tradition, Rus Slavonic tradition, excuse me. Mm-hmm. They were, so zamishlenie is a good example. I could find all kinds of usages which focus not only on the concept of invention, but even the diabolical, the religious connotations of those words. So the question would be, in all of these instances, was there need to focus on the Czech tradition, for example? But if where I'm going is somewhat correct, I simply took a very simple idea, which is this entire tradition, and I remember the way you phrased your work on Vyshensky when you talked about this remained non-secular for centuries, this whole idea. So I said, look, 99.9, I took any Zborning, 99.9% of these works are what they are. Most of them are from Greek, whatever. This is the tradition. I then took the chronicles, which form the basis for all subsequent chronicles, the PVL, as they still call it, or the primary chronicle. Mm-hmm. And I was struck by the clarity of the vision. If you read the sections that influence 1185b, it is a clarity that for me serves not only as the foundation for an understanding of the chronicles, but in my view, it has to serve as almost by necessity serves as the foundation for the Ihor Tail.